So I had revived this IBM P70 portable machine and tried making it work with these network cards. Nothing easier than that. Two 10 base 2 network cards and two for token ring. Let's just plug them in, right? Until I got this. Let's talk about legacy network technology. I'm the vintage collector and these are my stories. Alright, error code 165 is NetApp the mismatch error. Now, what does that mean? For that we first have to understand that the IBM P70 is a PS2 machine. PS2 stands for Personal System 2 and was a new lineup of machines released by IBM from 1987 onwards to replace the original IBM PC, XT, AT and DPC convertible. And in case you're spotting a similarity between the PS2 logo and the OS2 logo, then you're right. OS2, the new operating system to replace DOS, jointly developed by Microsoft and IBM, was indeed intended to become the main operating system for the PS2 line of computers. And although OS2 was indeed capable to run on standard PCs likewise, it is rumored that because of the namesake, people didn't receive it as a PC-compatible operating system, hindering its market acceptance. But that's a different story. However, it shall be mentioned that OS2 was in delay, so the PS2 systems had their market entry with PC-DOS instead. Still, OS2 was of course compatible with the new PS2 BIOS, of which there were actually two in the system, the Advanced BIOS featuring a protector mode interface and the Compatible BIOS which provided the same real mode DOS interface as previous versions. So IBM was obviously introducing a new standard with the PS2 systems and that for several reasons. For one, because the original PC architecture at this point had already proven to be very successful, and although the technology for the original IBM PC was literally just slapped together from the off-the-shelf components, and the architecture was kept open, clone builders quickly showed up and soon after built systems that were eating away from IBM's once dominated market. Said that, the original PC architecture also had its flaws and limitations, which called for better solutions, especially when it came to the dated AT bus. So IBM introduced the so-called Micro Channel architecture with their PS2 lineup. It was the answer to all problems, as not only did it decouple itself from the x86 dependency, but also introduced an improved edge core connector system, adding for better grounding and power distribution. It also introduced a 32-bit wide bus running at 10 MHz, which increased the attainable speed up to a factor of 5 when compared to the ISA bus. Plus, it added autoconfiguration, which no longer depended on manual configuration for IRQs at all. I've discussed the latter to some extent in one of my earlier episodes about ISA-based network cards. So for the microchannel it was all but different. In fact, some say MCA was a bit like an early precursor to plug and play, as every microchannel card had a unique 16-bit ID to identify it. So vendors simply had to provide option disks for their adapter cards. These option disks contained so-called adapter description files, ADF for short, which contained the resource configuration information. And using said ADF file, the adapter could be configured to use in the system BIOS. But this is where a good idea becomes a dead end. Because said error 165 means nothing else than the BIOS detected an unconfigured adapter card. But neither the original IBM PCs nor the PS2 systems of the time had a readily accessible BIOS setup utility in ROM, so nothing there to respond to F1, delete or any other magic key combination like in later years. Instead, you needed to boot up the system from a so-called reference disk. And dare you hadn't it at hand, because as you see here, there's no way I can skip and continue booting. At its best, I can press F1, which just loads into ROM Basic. That's it. No disk boot, neither from the hard disk nor from a floppy, unless you insert the reference disk. And it totally wouldn't have been possible for me to even boot off the reference disk had it been for today's episode sponsor PCBWay. As shown in my last episode, PCBWay stepped in for producing these fully assembled adapter boards, which make it possible to replace any broken PS2 floppy drive with a standard PC style floppy drive or even a GoTek floppy emulator. Alright, you can boot from a DOS system disk if you had the boot sector modified by the so-called REFSTAMP utility. But that won't save you, as obviously the adapter mismatch error seems to have invalidated the previous known good BIOS configuration in a way so you wouldn't load at all. That also means that the hard drive isn't accessible even when booted from the REFSTAMPed DOS system disk. And that matches with the previous observation that in this scenario it wouldn't boot off the hard drive but just into ROM basic, as if it had lost all settings, which it probably did. So a reference disk is what's needed, and luckily that can be obtained online. However, that reference disk surely won't match your system, so the only thing it can do is offering to do an autoconfiguration, which means reconfiguring everything from scratch. That also brings me to the biggest pitfall. Obviously, the existing configuration cannot be retrieved from the BIOS itself, but exists in readable form only on the reference disk. That said, if the disk is lost, it's gone. Period. Now imagine that in companies with hundreds if not thousands of systems where every system called for its individual reference disk. Terrible. And probably one major cause why the micro channel didn't last beyond 1995. Well, aside from the fact that IBM culled between 1 to 5% of the revenues in royalties for anyone licensing the micro channel technology. It's clear that IBM attempted to take back control of their market using this measure. But obviously, they had underestimated the Gang of Nine who came together defining the ESA standard to evolve from ISA instead of becoming locked into the MCA dependency. Hadn't it been for these reasons, maybe the PS2 systems and DOS microchannel may have lost beyond 1995. Who knows? At least the PS2 style keyboard and mouse connectors have become widely adopted, surviving well into the 2010s, however disappearing more and more in the recent years. Back to my IBM P70, which I had been trying to boot off the reference disk. At least until that point where it asked for the option disk. As I didn't have one, I tried skipping it, which resulted in a still unconfigured and thus unusable system. Now, I know that plugging in ISA cards into a classic PC, essentially not caring for proper IRQs and IO addresses, could also lead into an unbootable or crashing system. But I totally don't get how this approach as experience here on the PS2 was necessarily better. Yeah, I said it myself, I need an option disk containing the ADF file. Back in the days, you hopefully had received the option disk from the vendor. But nowadays, chances are you just got the adapter card, like I did. Maybe you're lucky and the card has some descriptive names or type identifiers on the silk screen, or an online research to compare pictures can help in locating the correct option disks. Or you use those bootable floppy disks with either the QBMCA or IDMCA utilities. These disks are REFSTAMPed as well, so they will actually boot and give an indication about any detector adapter card, even if they're not properly configured yet. And so it does, which is a great help to properly identify those four network cards I have. I was particularly surprised to find this one here to be a Novell NE2 network card, as I just collected random pieces without really paying attention. So how to create an option disk with those ADF files then? Ardentool.com has a fairly complete collection to which I can map my adapter identifiers, those being E001 for the IBM token ring adapter, 61C8 for the SMC Ether card, 002D for the match 16/4 ring node card, and 7154 for said NE2 network card. Ardentool also furtherly explains that the ADF files need to be transferred onto the reference disk. We'll try this in a moment. However, one should note their recommendation to not just simply put the ADF files onto a random disk, as for IBM adapters this won't be sufficient. I'll anyway create a single disk image with just the ADF files on it, just in case. Luckily, they also have the images for the IBM token ring adapter card and a plethora of drivers and software for the SMC Ether card. And this one seems to include a packet driver, so maybe I can get it working with my TCP/IP boot and diagnostic floppies I crafted earlier this year. As for the match and netware adapters, there seem to be no further disk images or drivers available, so the AFDs will have to suffice. So after I created a bunch of floppy disks, I then went with the SMC Ether card. At first I had created a driver disk from the ether.exe download, which has all the files within an ADF subdirectory. But that didn't work, obviously the PS2 reference disks don't like things in subdirectories. So I went to use my standalone ADF disk, where I had intentionally put all ADF files directly into the root directory. And that seemed to suffice for the reference disk to configure the SMC Ether card and then perform a system reset. As mentioned earlier on, I had found a packet driver for this network card, and so I wonder if I could simply load it up using my DOS TCP/IP diagnostics disk. Though I first tripped into a problem with the DOS boot menu. It wasn't readable at all. And that goes back to configuring the white and blue ANSI color start menu. Now, that's maybe not the best of all ideas for an all monochrome display, and as we can see here, especially not for an amber on black display. So let's get rid of the colors, shall we? Ah yes, much better. Now I can read what's going on. And when asked to proceed with the pre-configured default driver, I chose to skip it. At this point, the SMC driver was not a part of my boot floppies, so I'll have to swap in one of those driver disks I just had created before. After looking around a bit, I found that just running packet 8000 with the 0x60 software interrupt should do. And it does, the driver recognizes the micro channel adapter card. That's a good sign. So I quickly wired up the network card using an RJ58 coax cable to one of those 10Base2 to RJ45 converters you've seen on my earlier episode. And while I continued booting off my TCP/IP boot floppy disk, I would indeed get a DHCP reply, so my system gets a proper IP configuration. And voila! Ping Quad 9 proves I'm on the network and can reach the internet. I then plugged in the Accton network card, which claims to be a Novell NE2 or compatible card. As you see, I deliberately left in the SMC network card as well to see what happens. As expected, the PS2 BIOS would complain again and ask me to provide another adapter description file. And I may add one observation here. While it did ask me for slot 2 before, when the SMC card was inserted, it now asked me for the unknown card inserted into slot 1. So far so good. But one shortcoming in my opinion is anyway, why doesn't it tell me what card it recognized? Remembering those identification utilities I talked before. The way they do it is by having a database file which contains all known 16-bit device identifiers and mapping them to a human readable name. Obviously, the PS2 reference disks don't contain anything like that, so it can't tell names. It doesn't tell the device ID either, and of course, it's questionable if anyone would have had a benefit if it told you something like adapter 0x7154 hex in slot 1 needs to be configured. And I really don't mean to criticize here, but just to point out the fact how easy it has become on our present-day systems, where we get to see human-readable device identifiers, which make it so much less cryptic. We've come a long road here. Anyway, once configured and booting into my DOS TCP/IP boot floppies, I meant to repeat the same procedure again with packet driver. While I somehow didn't find original drivers for the NE2 card, I found an NE2 packet driver over at Crinware. However, when running the NE2.com packet driver, it didn't seem to load, and even so, it didn't spit out any error messages. Just out of curiosity, I then tried the standard type NE2000 packet driver, which did something? Well, not really a success. Maybe I need to dig deeper. Obviously, just going by the search terms of Accton and the part number found on the network card didn't prove successful. What helped me though was scouting through the retro web, where I eventually found one card that seemed to match. The Accton Ether Coax NE2 EN1623. And although the retro web says it's an ESAR card, going through the further description reveals this is likely a mistake, as both the ROM and jumper positions and also the description found here rather matches the micro channel adapter I've got here. But why isn't it working? While I actually had planned to investigate the source code to figure out what's going on, I found this directory here, which seems to contain an older version of NE2.com. And guess what? This one seems to work, as it shows some more reasonable output when loading. And indeed, my TCP/IP boot floppies would then behave correctly, and once loaded, I could ping Google's Quad 8 DNS server. Mission accomplished. And of course, I'll be updating my boot floppies on GitHub to include these latest changes as well. So, you may wonder what's up now with those token ring adapters, if and how they function correctly, and how to even join the network. But I'm holding that one off for an upcoming episode when I'll be exploring into the full extent of token ring networks. Meanwhile, what do you think about the microchannel architecture and the PS2 way of configuring things? Share me your experience and opinions in the comments below. And if you feel like supporting this channel, then why don't you check out my options about gear donation or paid membership subscriptions. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday, when I might be looking into AIX. Should I get the bloody thing ever booting off this machine?